You are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hi, I'm Dr. Pamela Kreiser, and welcome back to NCR 507, which is Research, Design, and Interpretation. Now, today we're here to talk about an important statistical test. We're going to talk about the independent samples t-test. And this t-test is something you may have heard of before. It is probably one of the most common tests around in terms of statistical tests. And so we're going to talk about it, but before we get into the specifics of it, let's take a look at the different models that we're using for our class in order to understand where it fits in. Here we see the chart that helps us understand the landscape for the six tests that we are going to be using in our class. Now, as we take a look at it, we notice that the independent variables are indicated at the top, and we know that in most cases it's only one independent variable. And then here, in all six of our models, we have only one dependent variable acting. Now, in the previous episode, we talked about the chi-square, so we're going to be done with that one. And now we're going to talk about the t-test. And so that is this model here. And so one of the things I want to show you, though, is that these are all tests looking for differences. And so that's kind of an interesting thing to note as we're evaluating the content and the models side by side, to notice that the chi-square, the t-test, and the ANOVA are all models where we're looking for differences. And then in contrast, here we see these are all tests of relationship. And so when we get to the last three models, we're going to be specifically talking about relationships. So let's go back and start talking about the idea of the t-test. Now, one of the things that you notice in this chart is that it has a categorical independent variable, and it has a continuous dependent variable. And so what does that essentially mean? That means that we have a categorical variable that's independent, and we're looking at a dependent variable that has continuous data. Now, as we think about this, we're thinking about a basic test that involves looking at the average scores in two different groups. It's very simple. So when you think about a t-test, I want you to think about the idea that I have an average score in one group and I'm comparing the average score in another. That's essentially what a t-test is. Now, one question you might be asking about is, what about an independent samples t-test? Like, what's the difference there? Because there are many kinds of t-tests, actually. And so what does it mean? It means that the data were collected independently and that everyone answered only one time. That's it. And so it's an independent samples t-test, and we use it to identify an average score in one group and compare it to an average score in another. Now, one of the basic assumptions that we want to talk about is the assumption of equality of variance. And so as we think about these two groups, one of the things that we want to observe is when we make that comparison, we want to make sure it's a fair comparison. Now, what do we mean by that? It means that when I make that comparison, I want to look at it in terms of, can I fairly evaluate that? And how we look at that fair assessment is to understand whether it has equality of variance. In other words, are the scores in one group equally varied compared to the scores in the other group? Now, let's think about an example that I think about from time to time. Let's say I gave one class a set of quizzes, and then I gave another class a set of quizzes. And if in one class I had a wide variety of scores, I would say that it had a lot of variance, right? The scores are varied. But in the other class, let's say everybody got 6s out of 10 on their quiz. Well, then we would say it has no variance, right? It would be, the average score would be 6, but everybody got a 6. So when you think about those two groups, we would have a lot of variation in one, and then we had almost no variation in the other. Now, as you're thinking about that, of course, that would break the assumption of the t-test. So we wouldn't be able to make a fair comparison. Now, luckily for us, we have a way to adjust for that, which I'll talk about partway through the show. So we want to identify that we're looking at average scores in two groups, and we're comparing them to see if we have not just difference, but significantly difference, significant difference. And so as we make that comparison, we're looking to see, because we know they're going to be different averages, but the question is, are they significantly different? Now let's take a look at the screen and start to look at the t-test. Now, one thing you're seeing here is a set of raw data. And so let's identify the independent variable and the dependent variable. And so one of the things we said is we have two levels of the independent variable. In other words, we can compare two groups at one time. So let's take a look at this independent variable here. And as we see it, we see that there's program A and program B. So we have an independent variable with two categories. And so then we also see that our dependent variable here is rating. And so we see ratings for group A, and we see ratings for group B. And so what we're going to do is create average scores for each of the groups, and then we're going to compare that, okay? So this is not, by the way, two dependent variables. It's one dependent variable, so everybody did a rating, and then each half the sample was exposed to one part of the independent variable and half to the other. So let's take a look at the next slide. And here, we identify that we have the degrees of freedom for this particular model of the t-test. And so this is an important thing to know about because the degrees of freedom indicates how the scores could possibly vary. And the formula for the degrees of freedom for a t-test is very simple. It's n1 plus n2 minus 2. So we know that in our particular example that we just saw, we know that it was 5 people in intervention group A and 5 people in intervention group B. And then we're going to subtract 2, and that gives us 8. And so we can see that the degrees of freedom for this particular t-test is 8. Now, if I ran the program, or I ran the t-test, then I would be able to look at the results on the output pages. And of course, if you're joining us today on the show and you haven't had a chance to see SPSS, let's take a look at that here now. You can see that here's the data for 10 people. So that's here. So we have 10 rows. And here we have the independent variable. And here we have the dependent variable. So pretty simple. And then we can look at the scores for group one. You can see this is the first level of the independent variable. And then we see the average scores for the other. And so you can see how the data are laid out. And then if you watch the other video that explains the SPSS part, then you're able to understand how to run this test. So let's take a look at what would be the first set of results back after we run the independent samples t-test. So the next screen shows us the average scores. Now, at the most basic level, we are comparing this score, 91.00, to this score, 74.20. What does this mean? We know the average scores are going to be different. This is just the rating of the program, right? So if I asked 5 people who went through program A to rate the program, and that's their average score is a 91, I'm comparing that to those who went through intervention program B, and their average score is a 74.2. Now, as I look at it, they look different to me, these scores. In fact, I might even guess that they're significantly different, but I would know better than that because I know I can statistically analyze the data. And so as I look at that, I'm comparing these two mean scores, and then I also observe the standard deviation right here, and that gives me kind of a window into whether I have a variance issue or not. And it looks like I could have an equality of variance issue, not sure yet. So anyway, at the most basic level, this is the comparison that I care about the most. And so let's take a look at the next screen. And when we see this overall screen, I want to give you a view of it, and then we're gonna take a look a little closer here. The first thing that we see here is Levine's test for equality of variance. So that's this box. And then we see the independent samples t-test box here. And so I want to show you this real quick before you get into the details of either box, because I want to explain what they are. Now, this Levine's test for equality of variance, this one, we know that this particular test is looking for whether we have a significant problem. So when we look at this box, we're looking to see whether there's a problem of the variance. A minute ago, I explained we have to have equal variance or relatively equal variance. So if this Levine's test is significant, it's significant for a problem in the variance. And then the second box here is the actual t-test results. And so that's something that a lot of students get confused. They forget that this is actually the most important box, and it's the one that tells us whether there's an actual difference. So as you're looking at the output file, make sure you understand what you're seeing. Now let's take a close-up look at the Levine's test for equality of variance real quick. So when we take that same output page and we look at it more specifically, we notice that we are seeing the Levine's test. And so remember what I said, it's sort of like a pretest, like to how to think about the t-test. And so it's saying, do I have a significant problem? Which is a little different than a significant difference. And so when I think about this, I care about these two numbers here. And so I'm going to report it just like this. I'm going to report the f here. 736. And then I'm going to report that it is not less than 0.05. Okay, so notice this number is 0.051. So it is not significant. So I do not have a problem with equality of variance. If it was significant, then I would have to do something special. I'll show you that in a minute. So as you take a look at this, just know what you're seeing, and that is, do I have a problem with my variance? And in this case, I don't. So I would just simply report the Levine's test for equality of variance, and then I would be able to move on. Let's take a look at the next screen that shows us the t-test boxes. And so as we look at these boxes, remember what I said earlier, these are very, very important boxes because this gives us the answer. And so as we're looking at these results, we can see the very important t statistic, we can see the degrees of freedom, and we can also see the p-value. And so let's look at how we might write that. We'd say it's t, and then we're going to put the degrees of freedom in parentheses. Remember, that's 8, n1 plus n2 minus 2. It's also written here. And then I'm going to put the t-value in, that's this number. And I see that this is, in fact, less than 0.05. So it is significant. So here I have the 8, which is the degrees of freedom. I have the 2.55, which is my t statistic. And then I also have the p is less than 0.05. Because remember, we want to be 95% confident. And that means that our p-value is 0.05. And our significance has to be less than 0.05. So here we see the results are reported and we see that it is significantly different, meaning those two mean scores are significantly different from each other. Now let's go back to the main screen and take a look at that so that we can identify what would happen or how to think about what just happened in terms of these results. So remember, we looked at this box first. And here, as we looked at this box, then we noted that this number was not significant. And when that is true, when it is not significant, then I'm going to assume equality of variance. And what does that also mean? That I'm going to read the top line. That's because this was not significant. So as you look at that, remember that this particular test tells me what I'm going to do in terms of which line to read. And when it's not significant, then I know that equality of variance can be assumed. I can safely assume it because I don't have a problem present. Now let's take a look at the next chart because it's an example of when we have an equality of variance problem. This is a little different from the data that we just looked at, but I want you to notice this, that here I have an equality of variance problem because this is less than 0.05. So this is less than 0.05. And so when that happens, I cannot assume equality of variance. I have to say that equality of variance is not assumed. And so what does that mean? That means that I read the lower line. And so I report this set of data, and then I drop down. So if we were to look at it, we'd report these numbers and these numbers. And so I'm dropping down when this is significant, when p is less than 0.05. And so that Levine's test for equality of variance, then we know that equality of variance is not assumed here because I was significant in this case for a problem of variance. And so it's a special case, and it may or may not happen, but it just tells us that we need to make some adjustments to the model. And then that is a nice correction that SPSS can make for us. So now we want to return back to the mean scores here. And as we look at this page, we can identify that this page shows us these different mean scores. But now that we've done the analysis, we know that they were significantly different. In fact, we can say that program A is rated significantly higher than program B. And so that is the result of my study. So remember, we started with the research question, do the programs differ significantly in their ratings? And here we can identify that yes, they differ significantly. In fact, program A is significantly higher than program B. Now let's talk about those results a little bit. As we identify this, then we can say with confidence there is a difference. And as you're evaluating that, then of course you need to now explain the results since you're the researcher. So we see a difference in the ratings. And now we're going to have to explain the why to those who are reading our research report. Now, of course, we can't say for sure that results are due to any particular thing, but we could say that perhaps it is the resources. Maybe there's more resources in program A, and that's why we would explain the ratings to be higher. Or maybe we would say there are fewer resources in program B. Or perhaps we might say that the methods used in one of the programs is better or worse than the other. And then you, as the researcher, would fill in the blanks of some reasons why you think it might be the case. Now, as you're going to do these explanations, make sure that you understand your role is not to explain exactly how everything works. Your job is to explain that the difference is significant, and then you can speculate or try to explain with some good reason why you think the difference is the way it is. But remember, you want to use phrasing like it could be, or it may be a result of, or it might be due to. And as you use those kinds of phrases in your writing, then you'll be able to leave the door open for multiple explanations. Because remember, your job is to report the findings of your data and your analysis, but not to explain everything that goes on in that area of inquiry. So as we think about the t-test then, we've observed a few important things. One is that we know that the t-test involves a categorical independent variable, and we know that that is a two-group comparison. And then we know the dependent variable is continuous, and that produces a meaningful average that we can compare for the two groups. So as we're looking at the t-test, we're observing that it is a two-group comparison, meaning we're comparing average scores of one group compared to the average scores of another. And so as we look at that, we can identify that that is essentially what the t-test is. We also observed in this show that we're talking about a quality of variance. So as we think about the variation of the scores in the two groups, we know that we are assuming they're relatively equal. The good news, we have a computer to analyze if there's an issue. And so we know that as researchers, if we detect a problem with one of the assumptions in the t-test, then we can actually make an adjustment in the reporting of the results. Well, thank you so much for joining me today to talk about independent samples t-test, and I hope that your day is not just different, but significantly different.